to the needs of the society by organizing social service activities through two forums, Nirman and Abhijnan. Karthik Aneja of Information Systems has won an award for his video produced for underprivileged students. The TEDx Bits Go By event organized by our students for the successive third time during the Techno Management Festival called Quark presented an extraordinary range of awe-inspiring stories from the most fascinating and extraordinary individuals who enthralled and encouraged the audience to participate, promote, and propagate. The team from our campus has won the Western Regional Finals of Chartered Institute of Management Accounts Global Business Challenge Competition for the third consecutive time. Shruti Balaji, Research Fellow of Biological Sciences, has received a Fulbright Nehru Doctoral Professional Research Fellowship at Wake Forest Institute for Regenerative Medicine. Our campus stands first among the campuses of BITS to send faculty members on 6 months sabbatical work to work on the research area with a professor abroad. I mentioned here about Dr. Narendranath Ghosh. The Department of Humanities hosted first Nehru Fulbright Scholar of BITS. This campus has hosted many eminent speakers of various topics of interest to students and faculty. Lord Meghnath Desai's interaction with students on the campus on 3rd April was an enjoyable and inspirational experience to all of us. Professor Anil Gupta spoke on the occasion of Professor V. Lakshmi Narayan Memorial Lecture on 16th of February. BITS actively supports entrepreneurial efforts of its students through multifarious initiatives of CEL, that is Center for Entrepreneurial Leadership. Last year, CEL of this campus got approval from funding from DIT, Government of India, for an incubation center in information technology. EC Mantra Technologies, Vipassan Labs, Spectrum Casuals, TotalEnt.in, and Cubito.in are some of the entrepreneurial startups by our own students. The center presented Agora 12, a national conference inviting young stalwarts from wide-ranging fields to share their stories of determination and passion of life-changing journeys and their inception. The Alumni Affairs Division of this institute keeps track of the progress of our alumni in their professional world. It is gratifying to note the urge of our alumni to give back to the campus. Embryo, a project by alumni, organizes lectures from US to all the campuses of BITS. Establishment of Cisco telepresence facility, comprising of desktop conferencing, 18-seater conference room, 200 capacity lecture hall, is a direct outcome of BITS alumni giving back to their alma mater, with the alumni contributing $600,000 for this project. This project will facilitate cross-campus teaching, video conferencing, and desktop conferencing for faculty and students of BITS. Sir, as envisioned by our Vice Chancellor and presented in his address, BITS is gearing up to meet new challenges with an ambitious growth plan for the coming years, and we are quite sure of our success under the dynamic leadership of our Chancellor, Dr. Kumar Mangalam Birla, and with the active support from our faculty members, staff, students, and alumni. My best wishes to the graduating students. Thank you, Ananda.
It is my proud privilege to introduce to you the chief guest for the day, Dr. Pachauri. Dr. Rajendra Pachauri has led TERI, the Energy and Resources Institute, first as a director beginning 1982 and later as director general since 2001. Since August 1998, he has also been chancellor of TERI University. In 2002, Dr. Pachauri was elected chairman of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC, established by the World Met Organization and United Nations Environment Programme. He was re-elected in 2008 as the chairperson of IPCC. IPCC, as you all know, together with US Vice President Al Gore, was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for the year 2007. Dr. Pachauri obtained his MS and PhD in Industrial Engineering and a second PhD in Economics, all from North Carolina State University, Raleigh. He has held faculty positions or research positions with Administrative Staff College of India in Hyderabad, North Carolina State University in Raleigh, West Virginia University, East-West Center in Honolulu, Yale University, and World Bank, Washington, D.C. He was also the founding director of the Yale Climate and Energy Institute from 2009 till 2012. He continues his association with the Institute as its senior advisor. Dr. Pachauri is also an advisor to the administrator of UNDP in the fields of energy and management of natural resources. For his many and significant contributions to energy, environment, and climate change, he has been conferred numerous awards, including Padma Vibhushan in 2008, Padma Bhushan in 2001, the Officer of the Legion of Honor by the Government of France in 2006, the Commander of the Order of Leopold II by the King of Belgians in 2009, the Commander of the Order of the White Rose of Finland by Prime Minister of Finland in 2010, the Order of the Rising Sun, Gold and Silver Star by Emperor Akihito of Japan in 2010, and Mexican Order of the Aztec Eagle by President of Mexico in 2012. Dr. Pachauri has been associated with a large number of advisory bodies in the world. I will not read out the names of all those advisory bodies, except to mention a few which are closer home. In India, Dr. Pachauri has contributed as member Prime Minister's Advisory Council on Climate Change since 2007, as member Economic Advisory Council to the Prime Minister of India 2001 to 2004, member Advisory Board of Energy reporting directly to the Prime Minister 1983 to 1988, National Environmental Council under the chairmanship of the Prime Minister 1993 to 1999, and the Oil Industry Reconstruction Group, Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas 1994. Dr. Pachauri, thank you once again for accepting our invitation. May I now request you to please deliver
my values and uphold ethics which would fully prepare graduates of BITS Pilani and Goa for the challenges that they would meet in life in the years ahead. I was asked to speak for 20 minutes, but I'm going to give you a little commercial on BITS Pilani in general, and therefore I hope the time that I spend on the commercial will be excluded from the 20-minute limit, as is generally the case. Well, the commercial I want to give you is from a personal experience. I came back from the US and joined the Administrative Staff College of India, and I was very, very eager to get into research activities dealing with energy policy. But there really wasn't enough money available, not enough funding available, so I got a small project to begin with, and naturally I had to make do with young people who could possibly help me on that project. And as it happened, I was offered the services of someone who wanted to do practice school from BITS Pilani with me, and I grabbed the opportunity. But of course I had some misgivings. I thought to myself, here's someone who's not even got a degree in his hands. Would he really be able to come up to the mark in helping me to do what I want to? And in those 6 months, I was amazed at the kind of response I got, the enormous dedication that this young man showed. And I can tell you, that taught me a lesson. Therefore, when he graduated, I employed him at the Administrative Staff College of India. And he's now somewhere in Houston, Texas. And often when he comes to India, he always sees me. But from that personalized example, I learned an important lesson, which I used to good effect while I was there in the staff college and throughout my career. And the lesson is that if you pick right young people, give them opportunities, and give them responsibility, then they will certainly rise to the occasion. And when I started research activities in Delhi, that's the principle I applied. And my institute, which now has over 1,000 staff, is essentially built on this extremely important principle. So I owe a deep debt of gratitude to BITS Pilani for having taught me something which otherwise. I may not have learned this lesson otherwise. End of commercial. Humanity is truly at the crossroads today, and our country is no exception to global realities and trends. There's often the perception of a wind of growing despair, disillusionment with existing institutions, and a cynicism which erodes all the good qualities of hope, faith, and optimism. India today has what everybody refers to as the demographic dividend. But this dividend is not similar to what shareholders receive at the end of a financially successful year in business. It is truly a dividend which I hope would revive the spirit and essence of India, an India which is dedicated to progress towards modernity, but deeply rooted in the country's rich traditions and its unique heritage. Indeed, the failures that we see around us, ranging from events on Wall Street, as well as the widespread continuation of poverty across the globe, are eloquent indictment of a lack of ethics, insensitivity to deprivation, which afflicts a large section of human society, and a self-centered interpretation of well-being, which in my view erodes the healthy condition of society as a whole.
Do you want me to switch off?
And if society fails, we cannot count ourselves as successful. No matter how much wealth we acquire and accumulate, and whatever distinctions we achieve as individuals. You would be aware of a major conference that was held in Rio de Janeiro in June this year, the Rio Plus 20 Summit, which at the end of a contentious period of discussion and debate produced a document entitled The Future We Want. Rio Plus 20 was very different from what took place 20 years earlier in the same city of Rio as the UN Conference on Environment and Development. At that stage, 108 heads of state or government took part, and of course, there was a large representation from civil society. As against that benchmark, Rio Plus 20 saw 88 heads of state or heads of government, but also a large representation of business and industry at the level of chief executives in several cases. Some may despair that this represents the takeover by business of the global agenda. But in actual fact, I would call this a welcome development, because given the role of business across the globe, we really cannot solve the problems inherent in an unsustainable pattern of development unless business is actively involved as a partner and as an initiator of change. That would of course happen only if leaders of business see some of our global threats as an opportunity and not as hurdles to business activity. I'm mentioning these facts because Vic Milani is the outcome and an emblem of corporate responsibility exercised by one of the tallest leaders of business in this country. It was the vision of Sri G.D. Birla and the enlightened stewardship of Dr. K.K. Birla over several years that has resulted in the establishment and growth of the Vic Milani family of institutions. It is therefore totally fitting that the Goa campus is named after Dr. K.K. Birla, a remarkable leader of business and a parliamentarian who I had the privilege of getting to know. It's truly heartening that WITS is not only a teaching institution, but integrates research with all its academic activities, some examples of which we heard a little earlier. In my view, education is not merely the ability to recall knowledge when it is required in a person's day-to-day life. More than that, it represents the unique ability to analyze problems in their entirety and total depth so that any solution is not merely a technical fix, but a response to every dimension of the problem. In this regard, I believe that an institution such as the K.K. Birla Goa campus of Vic Milani must realize the implications of any human activity on society's well-being and solutions that must cover this generation's well-being as well as the well-being of generations yet to come. In its simplest form, the definition of sustainable development embraces the concept of meeting the needs of the current generation without compromising on the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. And human society has ignored this principle to an extent that the transition to sustainable development is therefore much more complex and challenging today, far beyond what it would have been if we had adopted a sustainable path to start with. And here, may I say that much of this has happened because of lack of knowledge and awareness in the past. In fact, it was Albert Einstein who said, problems can't be solved at the level of awareness that created them. But today we have the benefit of awareness and knowledge, and therefore, if we assess the nexus between human activities and the Earth's climate, we see the impacts of our actions on a stable climate. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which I have the privilege of chairing, has found that the level of concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, which we have today, existed 650,000 years ago. And in a short period of just about two centuries, we have changed the atmosphere radically. At the beginning of industrialization, the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere was 280 parts per million. Today, it is close to 400 million. This has led to a